I'd like to first introduce our guest here today, peace activist Miss Lema Bowie of Liberia, who led a women's movement that was pivotal to ending Liberia's devastating 14-year civil war in 2003. A little less than 15 years ago, and now, Lema, you will correct me if I am wrong, but Lema helped organize an interreligious coalition of Christian and Muslim women, which became the Liberian Women Mass Action for Peace. It was a call to empower women to see their pivotal role for ending the war and making peace, and the movement grew. Dressed in white, these women of Mass Action for Peace launched non-violent protests like pray-ins and the Six Strike, demanding reconciliation and that high-level peace talks recommence. The women's message was that they were tired of war, tired of having their children killed, tired of being raped, and wanted peace. Ms. Bowie became the spokeswoman of the mass movement and was the one who was chosen to meet with Charles Taylor, the ruthless president of Liberia at the time, and managed to make him promise to engage in peace negotiations. And just to give you a snapshot from this time, and I hope we will hear more about this afternoon, but when the peace negotiations that took place in Accra had stalled, Ms. Bowie and 200 women formed a human barricade, refusing to let Charles Taylor and his regime or the rebel warlords leave the meeting hall for food or for any other reasons until they had reached an agreement. When security forces tried to arrest Ms. Bowie, she, as the Nobel Peace Prize website states, quote, displayed tactical brilliance in threatening to disrobe, end of quote, which according to traditional beliefs would have cursed the men. It worked and became a turning point for the peace process. In weeks, Taylor resigned and went into exile. A peace treaty was signed and facilitated for a transitional government to come in. A highly acclaimed film, Pray the Devil Back to Hell in 2008, is based on the story of Ms. Bowie's work. Her memoirs, Mighty Be Our Powers, How Sisterhood, Prayer and Sex Changed a Nation at War, were published in 2011, the same year as she received the Nobel Peace Prize. She is the founder and president of Bowie Peace Foundation Africa, providing educational and leadership opportunities to girls, women and youth in West Africa. So with these words, I would like to say how deeply honored I am to welcome you here today, Lema. It is not often that a peace researcher has the privilege to meet a Nobel Peace Prize winner. I will now just see if you would like to say a few words and otherwise open up with a few questions, and then hopefully we can have a quite kind of personal close discussion here this afternoon. So, Ms. Bowie, most welcome. And
thank you. You say it's not often that a peace researcher meet a Nobel Peace Prize. I think it is uncommon to find academics in peace meeting with activists. We tend never to find the space to sit and share our experiences. When we ever do have any kind of meeting, is one group trying to show how brilliant they are above the other group. So it's truly an honor to be here, and I think I will allow you to start with your questions, but I'm really happy to be here. My last time was 2011 after the Nobel Peace Prize, and then later on going to back for their peace event. So it's truly an honor to be back.
Thank you. The last time you were here, you actually met and discussed with our professor, Peter Wallenstein, here at, I think it was in the University Hall. I was in New Zealand at that time, so I missed that. But so we're happy to have you back. I thought actually that we might kind of focus this discussion around three themes that came to my mind when I was reading about your work and thinking about this session and the theme of this session, which is women, religion, and peace. And they're all interlinked, so they will weave together. But the first is women in peace building, and the second is women, war, trauma, and peace. And the third theme that came to my mind then is women, religion, and peace. So I thought that we could kind of discuss around these three issues. So if you have questions around them, you can kind of plan to slot them in when that theme comes up. But first, to open up perhaps the general theme of women's role in peace building. Some of you will know that a new study by UN Women, called the Global Study on the Implementation of, this is a very long name, I have to read, the Global Study on the Implementation of UN Security Council Resolution 1325 has just been released and was discussed last week in New York by the Security Council. So UN Women were commissioned to by the Secretary General a couple of years ago to conduct this study to see how Resolution 1325 has been implemented in its first 15 years of existence. Yeah, can you see? Resolution 1325, many of you will know, was taken in the year 2000, emphasizing the integral role of gender equality for peace and the importance of women in all efforts for maintaining and promoting peace and security. So this global study now points to that while much has been done, there is still a long way to go. They write that there is a crippling gap between ambition and political will, and emphasize the importance of ensuring that the norms spurred by 1325, those of women as integral in all aspects of conflict and peace, continue to develop. So I thought I'd like to begin by asking you, Lema, how do you think women mediators, women's civil society groups can be given or take a larger role in peace building today? How can they receive more legitimacy in a world that does not always listen to women?
Well, on this study, I was fortunate to be one of those individuals that was named on the high level advisory group. There was an architect of the study, and then there were a group of either 30 or 40 of us civil society activists that were named to advise the group. So we had a high-level advisory group of the global study. And the process of that study was an interesting one. The architect Radhika took a lot of trips across the world to interview stakeholders and women's groups and talk with individuals about 1325 and some of the problems and challenges of implementation. But to come back to your question, I think one of the things that we need to look at is defining peace process. Because over the last few, over the decade or 15 years, when women's involvement in peace building, especially since the 1325 came out, people see peace process as beginning when the table has been formulated by some international group. And I think until we begin to see peace process as the moment women begin to create awareness about the devastation in communities, because usually when we have wars, you don't have people necessarily understanding the dynamics of what is happening in country. As a matter of fact, over 10,000 persons have to die before the rest of the world wake up to say, oh, there's something happening there, you know? So women already start that work from the first firing of the bullet. They begin to have conversations among themselves to say, this is not right. That is the beginning of the peace process. Creating safety for other women and girls during war, trying to convince fighters not to be involved, that is the peace process. In some instances, disarming, all of those little things that they do that keep communities functional in the midst of war is the peace process. And I think until we get to the place as activists, as academics, and start to talk about seeing peace process from those moments, they will continue to disfranchise women at the table, which is the end. Because most times you see things going on for years before they actually get to that place of sitting at the table. So this is almost like towards the end of. And even when the table piece, the conversation at the table fails, you still go back into communities and women are not deterred. They continue to do that kind of work. We need to highlight those for recognition, because people will never really take women's roles seriously in peace building until they see that from the moment the first bullet goes off, these women are into proactive mode. And I think even it is safe to say, even before that first bullet, they are the ones giving early warning signal that our communities are about to, or our community is about to go into crisis. How do we take it? We need to, I think over time, the women's movement, and we had this conversation a lot last week in New York, have made a lot of concession. We are very comfortable with some of the political languages, and politicians have figured us out. So, okay, we gave them 1325 in the year 2000. First it was seat Beijing, then CEDAW, then 1325. So we're like, yeah, we're getting there. And then when we realized 5 years on in 2005 that 1325 was not really taking hold, then we start to agitate again. So 10 years later in 2010, they figure us out by saying, okay, every country needs to do a national action plan on 1325. So then the NAPS became the trending thing for the Women, Peace, and Security agenda. But the way I see the National Action Plan is fairy tale compliance. You know, in a fairy tale world, we will comply, we will give the National Action Plan. But in about 80% of the countries that have National Action Plan, there are no budgetary allocation and there is no political will for the implementation of this National Action Plan. That's what I call fairy tale compliance. Let's keep it there. They will see it, and when we go to the UN, we can report that, yes, we wrote it. In my own country, we're one of the first few countries in West Africa to develop a national action plan. Beyond the development of that plan at the Ministry of Gender, no one outside of Monrovia have heard of it. There is no budgetary allocation. All of the programs that we had in there never left that paper to go into the communities. So we go to the UN this year and they pass resolution 2242 without any hitch. All 15 members of the Security Council said yes. And we applauded. Then afterwards we read the resolution. The Women, Peace and Security agenda has been tied to counterterrorism. Then you ask yourself, wow, we've lost again. Because then the next day we'd go to launch the global study, and I decide on that day I'm going to be at my best behavior at the UN. So my speech was very neat and diplomatic. Afterwards, I regretted. Because every country that came to make pledge on the Women, Peace and Security agenda, their pledge was on counterterrorism. So then what you need to understand, before 1325, when 1325 was instituted, we had problems with implementation because of funding. Today, we're saying we have a global study, we review it, funding is a problem, they've tied it to the counterterrorism agenda. Money is taken again from the Women, Peace and Security agenda, that's the first thing. The second thing, women will continue to be disfranchised because our coming to the table now is tied to your understanding of terrorism. How many of us understand terrorism? Except that we are, again, one of the key victims of the terrorist agenda. So that's the second thing that is going to happen. And the third thing is, until you can learn that language, we will continue to struggle. So maybe we'll struggle for another 10 years. When we finally get it, then they will say another review. And that was my take when we launched the thing, that I wasn't sure we're going to get anywhere.
And in 15 years, my 6-year-old will be 21. And I don't want to go back to the UN with a 21-year-old and say 1325 has not been implemented and the actionable agenda of the global study has not been implemented. So now that the politicians and the international actors have figured out the language of feminism and the women, peace, and security agenda, we need to be proactive. I'd say all of the time when I'm talking to women's activists, we toast for too long. We celebrate for too long. Little gains we get comfortable with. It's time for us to continue to push and push and push. Last night, we were fortunate to sit with someone from who is close to your foreign ministry talking about your prime minister's new agenda of bringing together women's mediator. So I asked, what is the end goal? Because, okay, this government is seen as a feminist government. I'm now talking about the Swedes. And maybe next time I won't get a visa to come here. But this government is a feminist government. So your prime minister has again figured out the women. We know that in peace talks around the world, we don't have women. So one of the first things the politician does is to say, I'll go to the UN and declare that Sweden will have a team of women mediators. So last night I asked this person, so what is the goal? Oh. No goal. So is it just to bring 30 women of stature,
yes,
and parade them in the media and say, these are the women mediators of Sweden? Or I thought you would say, these are the 30 women. And for every peace process that Sweden is involved with, we will say, this is 2 million crowns, our contribution to this peace process. But you can only get this, and by the time they show their hand, wait a minute. We have two women here to be a part of the international mediation team. Oh, we never thought about it that way. So now it's up to the women and those who are interested in seeing this thing work for the feminist government to begin to agitate that it is not good enough for us to have 90 women or 30 women, just politicians, because even the caliber of women that are here, they're trying to put together, a lot of you who even understand mediation may be left out. So it's time now for people to start going, and that's the proactivity. Going to the foreign ministry and saying, we are women, we understand we need to meet with the foreign minister who is a feminist. Margo, let's sit down and talk about this thing. You're going to do this. This is our proposal. Can you have a round table of women and our allies to say how this thing is going to unfold so that it doesn't become a political or a policy agenda? Because in 15 years of the implementation of 1325, three things have been achieved: the political language, policy documents, and political rhetorics. Those are the three things that have increased in 15 years. So if you're talking about charting the success of 1325, we've been successful on paper, at the UN, in our parliaments, and at the EU. But we haven't really been successful on the ground. So I think it's in our lap again, as women, to see how we stop writing papers. The global study is 400 pages. I doubt if I'm ever going to read all of it. I will take chapters out, write speeches around it, take parts of 400 pages. I think this is where the bus should stop. And we should say, okay, look at Beijing, look at CEDAW, look at 1325, 44, 2244, look at the global study, combine it all. And let's start now with actionable agendas. Is that good enough to always ask for resolutions and policies and policies? And if you are indeed concerned, bring the money to go with this. I'll finally say, when we launched the global study at the UN, my sadness was, it was very insulting to the intelligence of the woman who wrote that study and to the intelligence of the group of people who have been supporting the study, because all of the governments that pledged money that day, no one pledged $1 million, I think except for Sweden. I think it was Qatar who was chairing the session, and they pledged 500,000. But that money was not for the Women, Peace and Security agenda. It was for counterterrorism. Some people, 200,000. But I was sitting on that high level table asking myself, if this was pledge for going to war, you know, so we took a quote afterwards, trillions for war, peanuts for peace.
And you know, Lema, if I just can jump in before I open up, there is also research supporting exactly what you say, what that has found that in the countries with national action plans, in a way, progress has gone the opposite direction, because many countries have then seen that if we appoint a woman to be head of the national action plan, and often within a ministry of gender, then we've done our work. So then we don't have to do anything else. So can I open up the floor for reflections and questions on this issue? Yes, Pumla, please.
I will start with a comment and
Sorry, Pumla, perhaps you would like to introduce yourself. So when you have a question, just to say your name and to introduce where you are from, so that thing.
My name is Pumla Gobodo Madikizela. I'm from Cape Town, South Africa. I am the Claude Ake visiting chair from the University of the Free States with the Peace and Conflict Studies Department. I am very honored to meet you across the floor. In August in Cape Town, there was an event where we organized with the Institute for Justice and Reconciliation and the Holocaust Center. We organized a viewing of Pray the Devil Back to Hell. The room was packed to capacity, literally, standing room, people sitting on the floor. And it galvanized so much interest, re-energized the commitment to peace, which is waning now in South Africa. So my question is, because I'm from South Africa and I've witnessed the resurgence of violence in a range of ways, which are not necessarily political violence at the moment, in different ways, in crime and so on, what has happened in Liberia now, today? What are the gains? Have the gains been sustained? And what is the role of your organization or women been? Has it been visible? If you could share a little bit about that, of what has happened in the aftermath in Liberia.
Thank you. I think I'll start by, sometimes, you know, in Nigeria, once upon a time, someone wrote this article, God, please take this oil away, because the oil had become a curse instead of a blessing. And I think I would make this very strong statement that when you sometimes get a woman leader, it ends up being more of a curse than a blessing. And in our case in Liberia, in two ways. One, it kind of divided the movement up in half. Because there were some of us who were saying, even though we had achieved the unimaginable by electing Africa's first female president, we still needed to be vigilant in terms of our advocacy around women's rights, governance, and democracy. Let us, those of us who put in the woman, be the ones to say, when she's going wrong, let's publicly chastise her so that people understand that we're serious about democracy, we're serious about sustaining the peace, but moreover, it tells that tomorrow, the communities will trust another woman because they will say there will be a community of women who will be here to speak out if things are going wrong. Oh my God, wrong mistake, big mistake for that decision. Because then you had another group that was saying men have been bad all along, so let's just let it be. So there is this division now of those for, those against, and some who have just gotten so sick and tired of all of the agitating and they're in a state of apathy. So initially, you will see that people were apathetic about political issues and all of this. Today, I've seen women groups that will be outraged at the signs of violence against women in Liberia mobilizing, just get to the state of apathy around violence. So like South Africa, we're getting to that place where This success now is a tool of disempowerment. So we've not been able to get a domestic violence law passed. We can't get a decent work bill passed because everyone in parliament wants the sexual harassment clause taken out because it's like we can't have that in there. I mean, everything around gender and women is being threatened right now. Rape is at the highest. Domestic violence is at the peak. And you just have all of these different things happening that you wake up in the morning and ask yourself, wow, even with a dictator government, we never really had these problems. Why are we sitting and allowing this to happen on our watch? You know, sexual exploitation, abuse in schools is at its peak. So you had all of these problems. The second thing that has happened to us that is going, that I will take you back to Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka was the first country, I think globally, in the underdeveloped world that had a woman prime minister decades ago or years ago. 2 years ago, after the end of the war or when the government fought the Tamil Tigers off, I was in Sri Lanka. It was just before elections. It was just around the conversation on reconciliation in Sri Lanka. So a group of women had taken me in to go and work with them 10 days in Sri Lanka. And every time, the only thing we heard at every meeting was, why should we elect women when we had a woman prime minister who did not serve us right? And I was like, wow. 50 years ago or 60 years ago, and you're still blaming women for one woman's fault. But all along, there's been men who have taken this country way into the depth of poverty, and you don't see them as the problem. But this one woman has become the symbol of women's leadership. That is another problem we have. It's not just a Liberia phenomenon. It's a global phenomenon. When women are given positions of authority, the indictment is on every woman if they fail to perform well. If they do very well at their jobs, that success is not for every woman. It's an individual success. But the failure, so now our president has lost so much popularity back home to the point now that 2017 is coming. We're worried that we will lose the few seats that we have in parliament if we're not strategic. So that's the second thing that has happened. So where is the hope? The hope is that we still have fiery women. The hope is that we have a whole generation of young people who saw us do great work. The question is, who is going to begin that convening power again? Who's going to start convening women? Just come together. Let's not talk about what has gone wrong. Let's talk about the future. Even though you need to heal your past in order to talk about the future, but time is not in our favor to bicker and blame each other and shift blames across. Let's talk about bringing more women in, bringing them in with an agenda, and then when they're there, we can talk about where we went wrong in the first place. So we have that problem, and it's good to speak the truth, because that is a serious problem that keeps me awake at night. And when I go to the country, sometimes I hide, because the consultations are many. Many women will come and say, what are we doing? How are we doing this? How can we change this? And then you sit there and say, I don't know. Because everyone is carrying a piece of hurt. I haven't spoken to our president for 3 years. Because in 3 years, in 2012, when I criticized our government for corruption, the government's tactic was to pay women to go on the radio to launch media smear campaign, not just against me, but against my children. So they went so low, the thing you call in boxing, punching below the belt, it was even worse than punching below the belt. My vindication is that 3 years later, people can come back and say, oh, you were so right, we apologize. But it was a very painful moment for me as an activist. I was isolated, but then at the international level, again, I couldn't go to certain places, meet with certain people, because they just thought you're a troublemaker. I remember going to an event in California where I was the keynote, and some of the women from President Obama's government came to that event. It was a high-level meeting. And as I was walking in, I mean, like, really dressed like an African queen because I knew I had my swag on that night. Someone said, one of the women said, who's a high-level ambassador, here comes the troublemaker. And everyone turned and looked at me, and I said to her, ambassador, good evening. You forgot that I won a prize for making trouble. You know, and walk away. But it's difficult, you know. So to your question, we have a lot of work to do. We have a lot of work to do. And for those of us women who intend to see more women in positions, I think if there's a need, just as we say of the men, to form a pact and give them an agenda. And I think we as activists feel President Sirleaf in some ways, because she was never an activist, she has always been a politician. So she doesn't understand our language, she doesn't understand our walk, she doesn't understand our issues, she's in politician mode, and once I get there as a politician, I'm successful, I will play the game the politician way. I think had we come together and said, okay, bam, we are your BS supporters, this is our agenda, we would have seen things happen. Because in all fairness to her, when we used to meet and talk, there would be issues that I would take to her. And then she would say, how is this? And we'll talk about it. And she was very open to learning and speaking that language. I don't think we did very well on that end, coming back to the point of celebrating too long. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I hope I answered your question.
Yes, you did. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Other questions? Reflections? If not, I'll move to the next kind of theme, and that might awaken some other reflection. I become mesmerized by listening to you, so I could just let you talk forever, Lema, because there's just so much to learn from all of your experiences. So the next kind of theme that I thought we could focus on is this with women, war trauma, and peace building, and you've touched upon that some. Some recent research, including some of my own work, in fact, has demonstrated that the effects of war and the challenges that people face in the aftermath of war may be quite different for women and men. So we know that while more men are killed in war, more women are subjected to non-lethal forms of violence, like sexual violence. So many women continue living after war with heavy burdens, traumas, in their bodies and minds. Considering that most wars today in the world are civil wars taking place within a country, this means that after war, people have to continue living side by side. For some, that means having your perpetrator as your neighbor, seeing your perpetrator in the street, having your children in the same school as your perpetrator. In Rwanda, where I have done some of my research, women were, we found in a large survey study, contrary to our kind of common beliefs from studies in the West, they were more skeptical towards the peace-building process, more skeptical towards the gachacha, more negative towards reintegrating ex-combatants than men. And if we think that in the light of the traumas that they have been subjected to and experienced, this is understandable. And it doesn't mean that these women are not doing pragmatic work for peace, but that they are meeting great challenges in their everyday life. So I was thinking, Lema, what do you think about this? What could help women in the aftermath of war to facilitate peace building for them, despite these heavy burdens of war?
Well, after wars, I think most times we tend to overlook the fact that, as a matter of fact, before war, when women engage, like I earlier spoke about, in the processes of peace building, it comes at great risks of being traumatized and re-traumatized. But in the midst of all of these things, because their mindset is keeping communities together and creating a semblance of stability for those that they're catering to, they cannot stop to think about their traumas. They never stop to consider themselves. The way I talk about it is that we are sponges. So we absorb all of the dirt, you know, and you, if you think about a sponge absorbing dirt for years, it takes on and takes on and takes on. And it's very heavy, you know, and that's where women are. Until you're able to get them to wring out that dirt and re-energize and refuel, it's difficult for them to engage in the process of reconciliation, community reconciliation, you know, because the way I put it is you can't give what you don't have. You can't reconcile communities if you haven't experienced the process of reconciliation yourself. So one of the things that we do, simple things in the work, because we don't have a lot of resources, I recognize from my own life that there were issues that I carried for many years that hindered my engagement effectively in peace building. Because every time you go through the emotions of your own trauma and there is this real heavy wave of anger that tend to push you towards violence. And for the nonviolent agenda, you don't need that. So we started creating safe spaces where we'll go into a room and we'll throw pillows down and comforters, and we'll put a big bowl of water in the middle of the room, and we'll have a brand new bottle of perfume, a new bar of soap, and a new towel, and give each woman a candle. And we sit around that bowl of water and turn off the light. We are not restricted by time. So we get in there by 7 p.m. Everyone is as comfortable as they get. And in our native tradition, there is the Sande Society, which is the secret society for women. We say this is our Sande that we've created, because in the Sande, nothing leaves the space of the Sande to go out. And we invite women to talk about their trauma. I remember the first time I engaged that process, everyone said the thing I probably talked for 4 hours. Because all of the issues that I carried. So we turn off the light, and if you want to speak, we light the candle and give it to you. It means the light is on you. And you speak about your trauma for as long as you want. And afterwards, you are invited to get to the pail of water for cleansing. You know, to say that I've come, and if you know your perpetrator, say a victim of rape, XYZ person raped me, today I'm letting go, I'm forgiving you, and I'm washing off this. And a few weeks ago, because now I'm at Union Seminary in New York as a distinguished activist, I was teaching a class alongside President Serene Jones. And when I explained this process, she said, you know what, this is not just cleansing, it's rebirth. You know, you're giving these women their lives back. And usually the next day, if we have sessions, we don't start early, because most of the women who have gone through that process sleep till probably 3 p.m. That's how much dirt had been weighing them down. And then they wake up, revive, renew, and they're asking you, we have plans. I have never done that and never walked into a training room late in the afternoon that women did not have personal plan or a plan for a group. As a matter of fact, that's how a mass action campaign was born out of one of those sessions. I remember once meeting a woman who was part of Taylor's military group. She was the head of the port. So that was a big thing. She was commanding all of the ships that came in with arms and different things. She held the secret of that place in her hand. And she came to one of our sessions. And we had this thing. But this woman was very shy. And people who worked with her said she was very ruthless. But in the group of women, she barely talked. For someone who commanded such authority, she became a puzzle for me. as I facilitated work with them. And she came to like 3 sessions before finally agreeing to do this. And she sat there explaining that she was born of a very young mother who later got married, and she, as the only child with her stepfather, who abused her and found every reason to take her self-esteem away. She grew up in a space where she told herself she wanted to be a teacher. She would own her own school. Having taken care of all of her mother's children, that was her dream. And every time she would stand up to talk about her dream, her stepfather would say, "You are so ugly, you would scare the children if you ever decided to teach. The only place that would take you as a career person is in the military." And that's how she took her whole life and put it into being a military personnel. She explained this story and talked about childhood rape and abuse and everything. This woman cried and cried and cried and cried and went through this process. And then we have other process of reaffirming your self-esteem. So we did that, and we usually do that in the form of either telling women to write down one thing they wish they had as a young woman that they had never gotten. Some of the requests that we get when we do this work, one woman said in her entire life she had never gone to a nightclub, and she's always dreamed of wearing a pair of jeans and a white t-shirt. So we said, okay, we will make that dream come true. All of us went to a nightclub one night in jeans and white t-shirt, and this woman danced from like 9 till 3 a.m. You could not get her to leave the dance floor. But she would tell you that I can die in peace. This particular woman said because her beauty had never been reaffirmed, she had always been afraid of beauty pageants and things like that. So we organized a beauty pageant, put her in a team with women who we knew would make her a winner. We were not going to rig the process for her, but we made sure we gave her a team of women who were highly competitive. And so in our training room, no one's allowed to go outside to buy stuff. Everything that we bring to camp is what you use. And those women were able to transform a bodysuit into a bikini and different things. But at the end of this day, this woman won this beauty pageant. Their crown is a simple paper, their sash is tissue paper, and we take flowers and grass from wherever we can take. But she was holding on to those things as if they were real. 3 months later, she called me and said, "I need to talk to you." So I was wondering if something was wrong, and she said to me, "In 3 months, I'm sending in my letter of resignation." I said, "Really? That's huge." And she said, "Yes, but I sent for you to show you something. I've amassed a lot of money from this work that I've done, and I bought this land, and I'm actually building a school complex." She has one of the best primary schools today in Liberia. And she said, "I want to thank you because you gave me my life back." I said, "No, we all did it together." So I can, looking back at all of those stories and the work that I've done with women across parts of West Africa and parts of Africa, and even sometimes in European and American spaces, I tell myself, see how effective working with trauma is, not just in transforming societies, but transforming individuals who at the end of the day become leaders in society and help to better the lives of others. But the problem we have is that no one is interested in investing. I think the Church of Sweden and the Trauma Healing and Reconciliation Program in Liberia is the only entity that has been running for this long. Everyone who came after the 1990s came with a one-shot-off thing and they left. So you still have communities, and the Trauma Healing is one entity working in a country of almost 4 million people. And you know that when it comes to trauma, it's an everyday phenomenon. It's not just with war. It's with your life experience and things that you experience. So trauma healing is very essential, not just to reconciling communities, but to empowering women and getting them back to the place where they need to get to in order to exert everything that God made them to exert.
Incredible work. Open up to reflections. Yes, please.
Hi, my name is Peter. I'm a student at the Department of Peace and Conflict Studies. Mike, thank you for being here. It's an honor that you're here. My question for you is, you mentioned what goes through a woman's mindset when they're making these decisions, and that a woman, you know, generally cares about the community, and her surroundings, and everybody else before her. So my question is, what were you thinking of when you were forming that blockade, and that you weren't going to leave until there was a peace agreement that was settled? I mean, given the circumstances, the type of person you're dealing with, and just everything around you, just walk us through what was going through your head.
You know, that morning I had waking up. As a matter of fact, we had gone to Ghana with $5,000 from the Danish church mission. The church in Denmark, how is it called? Den Church Aid. They had, a delegation had come, and they had given us $5,000. That was our biggest grant ever when we started our protest. So it was that money that helped facilitate our going to Accra. And we anticipated 2 weeks of being in Accra, and we're there for over 3 months. But as we stayed in Accra, I observed the warlords really just increase in size and stature. And this thing was going nowhere. Every day the news from back home wasn't very encouraging. I remember just crying every day, crying until I developed a problem with the tear duct in my eye because I had to go to the doctor. And they said, you have to stop crying. And I was at a place where I was questioning the authenticity of nonviolence movement. I must be very honest. How is it that we're here for almost 3 months and these people are doing nothing? The international community continue to endorse their stupidity, and they make over $2,000 a day in DSA. That's why it's so difficult for people to want to end wars when they go to the peace table, because they have money coming on a daily basis. So I had gone to the offices of the West Africa Network for Peace Building that I worked with at the time, and I sat in that office, and I used to go on YouTube for Yahoo, which I still do today, first thing in the morning, to read news. And there was a video that fateful morning that they were showing bloody bodies and slippers and shoes and slippers, and the report was that these two little boys had come outside to brush their teeth, and a missile landed and crushed them. A young girl had just given birth to a baby, and the baby was in the room with her mother. She came outside and was hanging diapers. She and those two little boys were crushed by that missile. But when I look at the ages of the two boys, they were the exact ages of my two sons. The rage that went through me. So I went back and said, you know what? We're going to do something dramatic today. But the one thing that I say, and most times when I'm talking to young people about anger, I always say anger is very fluid. Anger is neither good nor bad. It's an emotion. You're a psychologist. And this is my own 101 psychology. Anger is very fluid. What makes a hero and a villain is the expression of that anger. So I tell young people, when you're angry and venting, you have two containers sitting in front of you, a nonviolent container and a violent container. And depending on where you decide to pour your fluid emotions is what is going to make the world either call you a villain or a hero. Dr. King was angry. Gandhi was angry. Mandela was angry. Tutu is an angry old man. I'm an angry woman. Hitler was also angry. Charles Taylor was an angry man. But all of these individuals that I just named decided to pour their anger in different containers. And today, you have those with good legacies, and you have the others who are villains in the eyes of the world. That anger that I went through, if I had the option of an AK-47, maybe the story would be different. That's how mad I was. But then also there was always this thing in my mind that you can never really become them. Because people who allow this anger to consume them are the ones who are sitting around that table as warlords. So that's how I went to that room, encircling those people, because I was like, this cannot be. We cannot continue to have this. So when we come back to the point of women nurturing society, thinking about everyone else, thinking about those three individuals, a young mother who baby would never get the pleasure of knowing her, two boys who would never enjoy life or play soccer again. They could be my children, they could be the children of others, but in my head, it was like, this nonsense must end. And that was the rage that was driving me that day. Yeah.
And then what happened?
Well, we went to the peace. I went to the peace hall and said to Sugars was my mentor, a Twitter Cooper. I said, Sugars, you need to send for more women. And she said, I said, busload of women from the refugee camp. So she said, okay. And what are you working on? I said, nothing. And so I'm just sitting there writing my hostage note. And so once the women arrive, but before then, the media people were like, it's going to be an ordinary day. We're not going to hang around here. So I went to one of the press guys from BBC West Africa and said to him, Kweku, you don't want to leave. And he said, why? I said, you have a news story today. He said, really? Tell me, what are you going to do? I said, it's either you trust me and stay, or you go and don't get the story. He said, okay, I will stay. So the group of women came, and the men were in the peace hall. There was a glass door. So I told the women, sit at the door and loop arms. So in that way, if we're going to be pulled away, you'll be pulling a whole chain of very heavy women away from a door. So they sat down. And then I tapped on the door and pointed to a Nigerian general who was sitting there who I knew and showed him the note. And he looked at me, I showed it to him and pointed at the chief mediator, General Abubakar. So he came, took the note from me. I said, please give it to the general. And general opened the note, and there was an overhead speaker. So he made sure to put it on. All you could hear, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, the peace hall has been seized by General Lima and her troops. So then the men decided they wanted to come outside. One of the guys wanted to challenge it and you wanted to jump over, and general told him, no, no one leave the room. But when they came and said they were arresting me, they released me when I threatened to strip. And the same security people who were coming to arrest me came back to say, oh, you need to send more women on the other side of the building because the men are jumping out of the window. So then the mediator came and took me and took Sugars, and we went into a room and they negotiated with us for over an hour plus, and we came back outside and they said, you released the woman from this point. So we will, but we want you to send the message back in that we're fed up. And if this thing prolongs again, the next group of women that we'll bring will be more women than you've ever imagined. So in 3 weeks or 2.5 weeks, we had a peace agreement signed. And we know that there are many factors, but many people also credit that action as the turning point for seriousness during the peace talks. Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah.
Very touched and impressed by what you are doing. We are always discussing, is reconciliation a good way? But when I am listening to you, it's no option not to to choose this way. But I have another question. It was ourselves who wanted to have the heading Women, Peace and Religion today. But I want to widen the perspective and ask you, what do you think has to happen with the understanding of being man in relation to violence, the masculinity and violence? What needs to happen there that women don't have to sit and force the men to go further in the peace negotiations. And the other question is, when I'm here, I'm listening to you, how you act in Accra, what you did in Accra, and then I think of our European Union and the question of the refugees and how they are not coming forward in what they are doing. Then I wonder, what do you think we citizens of Europe have to do to change the situation of the refugees in Europe?
But let me tackle your question on the refugees first and go to the second one. I think most times you find people mobilizing for change when they feel like it's impacting their lives. So trust me, if the refugees were coming in and flooding the streets of countries, people would be at the EU Parliament demanding if they felt that their comfortable beds were being threatened. That's the way I want to put it. But right now, there is this feeling of comfort. Yes, we have 10,000 refugees at the border between Sweden and Denmark. How does that affect me? I'm still going to work. My kids are still eating. Everything is still going well. I don't need to take any action. Some people who are passionate about it may be standing at the EU Parliament protesting daily. But if you ask those people, why are you doing this? There's probably a history in their own existence of going through this kind of problem. I'll tell you something. When I'm traveling now, I don't travel with my daughter, she's 6. But every time I see a mother traveling, either on airplane, train, bus, or car, that needs help, I'm quick to step into it. The question you want to ask me is, why is it your problem? Because I've been there. And I know how it feels to be traveling with a child, and you have a buggy, and you have a bag, and you have a very heavy baby, and no one is paying attention to you. As a matter of fact, people want to walk through you, not be very conscious of it. And if you see women, some women helping, it's either as young people, if they don't have children, they observe their own mother's struggle, or these women have also been the ones who have suffered such thing. Rarely will you find someone who has never gone through this experience reaching out. That is human nature. You're a psychologist again, and correct me if I'm wrong. But that has been my experience. So until this migrant crisis gets to the place where it begins to touch you and the comfort that you feel in your bed, you don't have any impetus to leave Sweden and go to Brussels to go and protest. You don't have anything to make you leave from here to go to Stockholm. It's people, they are just people. Yes, I feel bad. It shouldn't be. So you will sit in front of your TV and yap. Yeah, this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong. But as wrong as it is, there is no drive to take you from your bed, from your comfortable home, in the biting cold to go and protest. You know, so you have that problem. The second thing with the migrant crisis is that the extensions of wars that are being fought by great nations like the US, Russia, Iran, China, because they want to fight each other, but they can't fight each other on their home front because there's too much to lose. So let's take it to Syria. I will beat you down in Syria. So Russia launched a missile, the US launched a powerful one. They wish they could do it in Manhattan and in parts of Russia, but it's not something that they want to do because they have to protect their own people and their countries. So I hate you. So let's find a foolish government in the world that is willing to destroy its people, and let's extend our fight there. If those wars begin to reach home to the countries that are extending it there, trust me, people want to talk about the migrant crisis. Because the migrant crisis is tied to peace. You will continue. You are, and I am so glad that it's happening the way it's happening. My only sadness is that the U.S. doesn't have a sea route for people to go to. Because if there was a sea route for migrants to come to the U.S., they would definitely be standing there. It's time for the EU to get to the place where they're so fed up, or people living in EU countries, you, to get so fed up with this migrant crisis that you're protesting not just the allowance of these individuals in your country, but the end of the freaking war in Syria and Yemen. Because until those wars end, you will continue to see it. And if it prolongs, maybe one day, people will get upset enough to start to pressure their governments. But for now, it hasn't really come home to roost, as they say. So you don't have that drive to do what you want to do. Many years ago, I was in Uganda, and the women were there bickering about peace when Kony and his people were at their best, cutting off the noses and lips of women. I'm sure you've seen images of those.
Yes.
And so we're talking peace amongst the women in Kampala, and they're arguing about nonsensical things. And I was just sitting there smiling. So one of the women said, Lema, why did you come all the way from West Africa with a huge suitcase full of cynicism? I said, well, because I don't understand why you sent for me. Because if you're sitting here arguing about the politics of Kampala, it means you're not interested in peace in Gulu. Because if your comfortable beds were threatened, the conversations you're having right now would be totally different. And for a moment, everyone stopped in that room and said, it's true. We in Monrovia in 2003 realized that the only place we had to go was the sea. So then we really need to stand up and step up for peace. Because Liberia had been brought to a place where it was just Monrovia. And you look north, there was war. Southeast, there was war. West, there was war. The south is the Atlantic Ocean. So someone had to do something. So that's the situation. When people don't feel like their existence is being threatened, it's difficult for them to move for something that it has to be a part of their experience. During the peace talks, when we threaten to strip, I've often been asked what stripping would do for a country where almost 60% of the women were raped. Why would threatening to take off your clothes make a difference when you had a room full of men who gave order for people to rape, you know, randomly? But one of the warlords answered that question in a very good way. He said, when they came in the room and said the women were threatening to rape, each and every one of us looked at each other and asked ourselves, what have we done to bring our mothers to this place where they are now giving away the last shred of their dignity? The way I put it, when you're raped, you're forced to take off your clothes. But when you threaten to strip in protest, it's saying to the one who's offending you, you've taken everything away. And this last piece of my dignity, I'm giving to you in protest. And those moments are the moments that bring men to the place where they begin to question masculinity. Has it helped at all? Is this how I want it to be? Because that moment when a woman or a group of women is giving you that last shred of their dignity, you're asking yourself, all this powerful thing that I've been doing, it's taking something away from me. Because I'm no longer powerful. I'm sitting here weak. Because with every power that I thought I had, and have done something terrible to these women, they've brought their weaknesses at my feet in a very powerful way, and I'm immobilized. I can't do anything. So is this helpful to me? You know, it's almost like a father who goes out there. I was in London working with 300 girls from the Girl Scout during the 100th celebration of the Girls Guides. And there's this little girl, they were all supposed to do acts of peace in their community. She's going to grow up to be the next Margaret Thatcher in the UK in a very good way. She said to me, every morning, she'll open the center spread of a newspaper, and there will be one girl, either in panties and bra, and they had this company in their town that this ad, the ad that the owner of the company will put in to advertise his group was, or his products were primarily scanty women, scantily dressed women. And she found out that this man, this little girl was 10, had a daughter. So she gathered her troops of girls' guides, and they got cookies and said they were going to sell to this very wealthy businessman. And they kept agitating for days until he said yes. So this day, all her friends know they're going to sell cookies. And all she knows is that she's taking this newspaper to this guy. And she gets to his office. And of course, he has his media people, his PR people, to say, oh, this businessman is so nice. He's meeting with these little girls. Little did he know that he had one little girl who was a woman. What she's done with the model picture was to either cut it out. I don't remember the story very well now, but it had some reflections or reference to his child, and gave it to him and said, how would you feel every Saturday morning if you opened this and saw your daughter's face? I think it's wrong for your company to do this to women and girls. And they had their moments of conversation and left. But she reported to that conference that from that day on, that company used different things to advertise their products, because she confronted his strength with something that was precious to him. Yes, masculinity respond to sexualized women, and your company only answer to servicing the rest of the world is to sexualize. But when this masculinity is threatened or is confronted with images of weakness, but that weakness that is precious to them, there's a kind of immobilization that takes place. And I think that's what happened to the men in that room. And I've seen it happen over and over and over in spaces and places where you have warlords. We were in Arusha in August, Tanzania. And I'm with one of my favorite African women, Gedru Mongela, who is a powerhouse. She was with the movement for the freedom of Tanzania, the independence. She's been around for a long time, member of the Pan-African Parliament. And she saw one of the warlords from South Sudan walk into the hotel. And she smiled because he was a student when he was a refugee. And she said, you boy. I said, you boy. He recognized the voice. South Sudanese boy. She knew his name. And he turned. And she said, come here. This old lady is just sitting there. And he walked over to her and said, what are you doing here? He said, oh, now I'm in Tanzania. I'm doing this, I'm doing that. She said, come closer. He's this tall. You know, South Sudanese are very heavily built. To come close meant he had to kneel down. So he knelt. And as he knelt, she grabbed his ears and said, you will give peace to those people. He was very uncomfortable. He said, yes, Mama Gertrude. She said, you will give peace to those people. Yes, Mama Gertrude. And then she tapped at the empty seat next to her and said, sit down. And he straightened himself and sat down. She said, give me your telephone number, give me your address, and give me everything. Where is your other person? That person was higher ranking than he was in amongst the warring group in South Sudan. And he was very uncomfortable to give the telephone number. She said, I want it now, or else you're not leaving from here. So he went out his phone, make a call to this person and say, I'm giving your number to someone. I had no choice. He had to say that. And then he gives her the number, and she spoke to this person, called immediately and said, do you know who is this? Said, this is Mama Gertrude. Oh, she said, I'm coming to you tomorrow, and we're going to talk. This nonsense has to stop. But she went on to say, I remember you people and how your mother struggled with you as a refugee in this country to give you a good education. You went to school, you graduated, you're a smart young man. Why do you want to use the barrel of the gun as a means of... This man was so, I was so embarrassed. I'm really embarrassed. But it was not funny anymore for me, because you see a very dark man blushing. And you can only see that blush in the color of his eyes changing. But after she gets through talking to him, I'm saying to myself, wow, why is it that he didn't exert, you know, that kind of masculine behavior? Because she used something that would take that power away. Because that reference of his mother and how she struggled. And she knows the conversation as his teacher, what she and his mother used to talk about. And he just sat there. So after she got through talking, she said, you can go now. Have a good evening. I would have invited you to dinner, but it's all girls having dinner in that room. You know, and he just got up and humbly left. Then I asked her, are you going to follow up? She said, trust me, first thing tomorrow morning, I will be at where they live. And I'll continue to torture these two until they drop that ambition. You know, so there is something about that thing. And I think if we were not agreeing to some of the way masculinity exerts itself, if we're challenging, like we challenge every other thing, if we're challenging some of the patriarchy structures in that way, I think we'll get somewhere. And not trying to sidestep, you know, because at the end of the day, that warlord in Liberia who said, what have we done, is one of the biggest supporters of my work, even till today. Last time I had children's camp in July, and he was opportune to meet them because he's a high-profile government official. And then after the kids left, he pulled me on the side and said, when has it gotten to the place where you don't ask me for support anymore for your work? He said, you know, I'll do anything to make up for the years. I said, I know. If I need you, I'll come back. But right now, I'm in a good place. He said, even if you're in a good place, you know, but just come back to me. He's someone who will give to community initiative and to other things, because I think there's something about where he has been and trying to wrong the right. Yeah.
Yes, please.
Hi, my name is Mina. I'm also a student at the Peace and Conflict Research. I just wanted to ask you a question about rape. And I did a bit of study once, and the issue of male rape isn't really sort of something that gets acknowledged or understood. And sometimes one of the thoughts that I had was for, say, men who have been raped, their understanding of consent may be affected as well, and that could perpetuate part of the problem when and if they rape themselves. And I just wanted to know that in context of the high level of rape that happened in your country.
Well, you know, in our own country, there is this thing of, especially men who were violated, never talking about it. The only place that I have been able to see men talk about rape that they've gone through is Libya. Because they have this project where they are able to talk about some of the things. And the second place I've seen it is when I work with the Syrian activists. There were a few of the men who were able to, in tears, say, I was raped whilst I was in prison, you know. And I think it's just like with women, the whole concept of rape is taken away from people. And with the men, it's even greater. Okay, the third place was in DR Congo. And I think this will put your question into perspective. I understand from the activists when I was there that this pastor had been very vocal about the challenging the status quo, the fighters coming in and raping women. He had gotten a reputation for himself as a vocal advocate against the violence that had been perpetrated against women. So people were afraid of him. He was a power in the community. And a new group took over, and they were technically afraid of him, but they could not really, they couldn't find their way around softening his power. And the way they did it effectively was to rape him repeatedly. Once they did that, he left that community. And that safety that he created for the people was dismantled because they raped him in the presence of his wife. So today he lives in a different side. He's been treated and he's at a different place. He can't bring himself back to going into his ministry, and he doesn't want to see his wife and children. You know, so it's all about power over. You know, and as wars increase and as conflict increase globally, I think the rape of men will become more prevalent, like the rape of women, because it's about a group of sick people wanting to yield power over as many individuals as they can. Yeah. I hope I answer your question.
We have 1 minute left, and I was going to ask you about patriarchal structures in the religions of today and how this hinders the engagement of women in peace building.
I have been in this country for over 24 hours, and I've been really taken care of by the Church of Sweden. Why do you want to spoil that?
So let's leave that question.
I want to make a point. And the bishop and I had a conversation this morning, and we were talking about the migrant crisis. And I said, "Where's the voice of the church?" And they said, "Oh, we issue statements." I said, "Issuing statements is not enough. What alternative plans are you presenting to the government as church?" In the days of apartheid, the All Africa Council of Churches were very present in the center of the political conversation, providing social aid. I grew up in my own Lutheran church in Liberia with special Sundays collecting money to end apartheid. I think that was my introduction to social justice. And this were all informed by the All Africa Council of Churches. They were center, front, middle, sideways of everything that was happening in South Africa. So whether this group was calling peace talk, there was always a representation of the All Africa. They were a presence in all of those conversations. My question is, where is the church? Where is the World Council of Churches in this discussion around Syria? Where is the World Council of Churches in all of this discussion? That's the first thing. The second thing, if you look at the challenges we face in communities today, people rarely talk about issues affecting women in the church structure. Like, if we had dedicated days, like now we're about to have 16 days of activism, if it became a huge agenda item for the church to use those Sundays and days of the week to talk about domestic violence, because you know, in the church, is more prevalent than outside. The society mirrors the church. And when you're talking about patriarchy and the structures being entrenched, you just need to look at into the church. In our own church for many years, you couldn't be even president of the Women's Association if you were not married. What the hell? Marriage is just about being at home. How does that affect my ability to run a women's organization in the church? Those are some of the things that, and until the church begins to realize that women have something to offer. You know, it's good that you all have the first female archbishop in 850 years, the Church of Sweden. But I think it's time for more gains to be made, because then the rest of society, well, how do you criticize society for not doing things when you are not doing it? I'll end with a story that the Libyan government sent a delegation to the UN to talk with Ban Ki-moon. And as they got into the room, Ban Ki-moon walked in and said, "Wow, a delegation on peace from Libya, and there's not a single woman. And then the foreign minister of Libya said, "Yes, we're at the UN, and the SG just came to talk to us with his delegation, and there's not a single woman too." So I'm saying this to say that if the church is going to challenge some of the structures that takes a lot away from women, they should be able to lead by example. And leading by example doesn't mean making one woman a bishop after 850 years. It means doing more for the rest of the world to see that it's important for us to use these group of people in every way, because that's the only way we can get to the kind of equality that God wanted this world to be.
Thank you, Leima.